Good morning, all you beautiful love streamers out there, especially those of you who are on Facebook and eventually YouTube and Zoom. We'd like to welcome you to the Center for Spiritual Living Charlotte. I am your host, Horace. And if this is your first time, we want you to know that we are delighted that you have chosen to join us today. With modern technology, we are extremely grateful for this opportunity to touch so many lives. Especially as we share these wonderful happenings here at CSO Charlotte. So please feel free to visit our website, csocharlotte.org, put in a prayer request and subscribe. We add to our recordings and to our website each and every week. So who are these people that call themselves Center for Spiritual Living Charlotte? Well, I'm going to tell you. The Center for Spiritual Living Charlotte is a new thought community, living an ancient wisdom philosophy based on the science of mind. This science of mind philosophy was developed in the early 20th century by writer and lecturer Ernest Holmes. Dr. Holmes was a man on a mission. He studied truths from all of the world's religious traditions and spiritual paths. Holmes developed a fresh new way for us to look at ourselves and how we fit into our world. He's been referred to as the great synthesizer. So, here at CSO Charlotte, we want you to know that every philosophy is honored, along with every race, sexual orientation, and physical distinction. We are a diverse, open, and affirmative community. There are many paths to the divine. We may call it God, peace, love, spirit, infinite mind, or the I am presence. It really doesn't matter what you call it, but what is most important and what we want you to know that this is your power that resonates within you. You do not have to leave your philosophy or nature of knowledge. You can join us at any time. We recognize and refer to many of the holy scriptures, such as the Bible, the Quran, the Torah, the Upanishads, and the Bhagavad Gita. That's just to name only a few. So our vision statement here at CSO Charlotte is to continue a spiritual community, creating and preparing a succession of future leaders who can fully integrate, teach, and expose the science of mind principles, messages, and practices that strengthen the mind, body, and spirit of each and every individual. One of our aims is to create a high collective consciousness for everyone in this community. We teach everyone the tools to do just that. So come and join us as we meet every Tuesday evening at 6 p.m. for our consciousness studies. And you're going to hear more about that in our announcements. So welcome everyone and enjoy our service as we celebrate this powerful being, which lives within each and every one of us. So, before I pass the mic over to our wonderful and beloved guest speaker, Reverend Dr. Wanda, I want to leave you with this thought. First of all, I want you to know that her theme for today is How Do I Know? Listen to your life, it's talking to you. And so, with that, I want you to listen to this quote before I pass the mic over to her. Listen to the people from your heart as if your life depended on it. And you will find that in turn, people will listen to you with all of theirs. And with that, I'm going to pass the mic over to our beloved Reverend Dr. Wanda.
Good morning, everyone. I'm very pleased and blessed to be here today with all of these amazing people who dedicate themselves to showing up each week and creating this safe space. Thank you, Horace, for that introduction. And before we even get started, I would like to take a moment to just call in Groovy G to pray us in, to get us settled in, to get us prepared for the talk today. So Groovy, why don't you take it over?
Good morning, good morning, good morning, everyone. It is such a pleasure and a blessing to be here today, to welcome Spirit to help us enjoy and understand how Spirit wants us to live. how spirit takes care of us. We know that all is well in our lives and everyone's lives around us because we are all one, living this beautiful, beautiful day. Sunshiny here in New Mexico, it could be anything anywhere, even if it's raining, it's still beauty. We know that everything is going well for all of us. Technology is just fine. Everyone will hear the word and learn so much more about spirit. I release all of this into the nature of our world, and so it is.
And so it is. And it definitely is. Thank you for that beautiful prayer. So today, what I'm talking about is, or is there a song first? I'm sorry. I seem to have missed something here this
reader.
Morning. I'm okay?
Reader.
The reader. Aha, I knew I missed something. Hi, Melissa. Melissa is the reader today, and I just want to add that I had the wonderful opportunity to co-create the service today with Melissa, and was such a great help. And so I'm looking forward to hearing you do the reading, Melissa.
Thank you so much, Reverend Wanda. And yes, it's a powerful message that we're about to hear. And this morning's reading is going to be based on the message, listen to your life. It's talking to you. And this message, this reading is by Reverend Dr. Wanda Wayman. Every single person in this world is unique in his or her own way. But trying to copy others, customize, or build ourselves like them just because you want to gain attention or not feel alone or are in fear of being alone, this is not the universal truth. Everything is energy. We are all drops of water in an eternal ocean. This is an infinite field of unlimited possibilities and potentiality, true spiritual freedom. That type of freedom comes from making choices from our awareness of the connections between all things, choices made from our heart, not out of fear, obligation, coercion, or guilt of any kind. Choices that are not you trying to fit the uniqueness of you into someone else's ideas of what you should be. It is surrounding yourself with those who appreciate your uniqueness, those whom you are in relationships that celebrate the differences and present opportunities for opening up to something new, to challenge ourselves, to look within, to evaluate the choices that we make. And why? What needs to be healed or celebrated? Others come into our life for a reason, a season, or a lifetime. Are we trying to cling to someone who was only meant to pass through? What was the gift they dropped off on their journey passing through? Why do we seem to attract certain types of people? Is it just easier to stay in our comfort zone, even though it may not be supporting our highest version of who we have come to be and who we are going to become? Together, we are always teaching or learning from one another. When the lesson is learned in certain situations, do this. Do we make space for something more? Life is an adventure, designed to be lived out loud without apology, but with joy, creation, and purpose. Each day, take some time to evaluate your day. Just listen, close your eyes, and see what it has to tell you. And so it is.
Spirit must want us to really talk today. So, as Melissa said, we are each drops of water in a vast sea of potentiality and possibility. And The reason I chose this particular title is because I notice that often we don't listen to our lives. We're on a path and all of these things are happening, and sometimes it seems chaotic. And, you know, we actually are born perfect, whole, and complete. And then we come into existence on this plane, this dimension, this quantum field, this part of the quantum field. And then we're like a blank slate. And then life happens. Life writes on that slate. And it writes from the perspective of our family of origin. What are their belief systems? How were they always raised by generations before them? So it's a generational thing as well that's being placed upon that slate. Also, what is our gender? What are the ideas about what that gender needs to be? What it should look like? What it should be? What about our ethnicity? What about that group of people? Who are they separate from us? How are we separate from other peoples? That's where the separation starts. All of these titles are them and us, me and you. There's not a we in there. Many of you know that I'm Native American, and for gender, there is a word in Diné. It is not gay. It is not lesbian. It is not trans. It is not straight. It is a word for gender, all gender, that means ourselves. And that's what we're here to be, ourselves, totally ourselves. So when someone says to me, you know, who are you? You know, what pronouns do you want? Well, the pronouns are me, myself, and I. I have a committee here. It's me, myself, and I. I'm myself. That's all. That's all. That's all I choose to be. And that's all I was meant to be. Because when I was born, I was given a birth certificate. And on that birth certificate is the name of my parents, my mother and my father, and me. And for many years of my life, because I was the oldest of the children, I was the one responsible for everyone. I was the one that if something went wrong, it was my fault. You know, so I developed this idea that I was responsible for everything that happened wrong in the world. But the truth is, I went to therapy one time and I met a therapist who asked me to bring my birth certificate in. And I thought, why does he want my birth certificate? What's going to happen? So I brought it in and I gave it to him and he looked at it and he said, yep, that's just as I thought. And I said, what? What's in there that I missed? And he said, well, what you missed is I don't see the names of all these people you're responsible for. I only see your name on here. And that was a huge aha moment for me. I am responsible for my actions, my words, my thoughts, my life. And, you know, it's not easy to be responsible for yourself. It's ever so much easier to look at someone from the outside and point the finger over there. Because I can see what's going on in your life and I can tell you how to fix it. I mean, I'm not attached to your stuff. Therefore, I feel like I have the ability to share with you what would work for you, which is also ridiculous because none of us walk in each other's moccasins. Another Indian saying, you are all unique. You are the sum total of every experience you've ever had and everything you've ever learned and every experience you've ever had. And so you are totally unique and yet part of something that is perfect. It's a sea of love. We were birthed and breathed into existence with free will and we get to choose our paths and how we express. And that's the uniqueness of each and every one of us. And so we need to celebrate that. We don't need to tie ourselves in not trying to belong. And we all want to belong. We all want to be part of something. So here we've got this slate and we go through the first trimester of our lives with all that stuff being laid upon us. And then we get into the second trimester of life, which is around 20, I'd say 18 to 30 something, maybe 40, maybe 50, depending upon the awareness and the conscious awareness of each individual and the work that's being put into and the aha moments that have been brought to them. And so with that, we then spend that whole second trimester trying to get rid of all the stuff that we learned in the first trimester and get back to where we were when we came in as perfect, whole, and complete, as a blank slate, to be able to appreciate the beauty all around us and the fact that there is something greater than ourselves. My grandmother used to say we need to have faith, but I don't believe in blind faith. Faith because someone says something is so. My faith is the faith of precedence. My faith of experience of that thing that is greater than myself and the part it has played in my life. And so I listen to what it has shared with me and where I am today as a result of releasing myself to that, to listening to that. And what that has done for me is, like my grandmother said, the words F, the spelling of faith, F-A-I-T-H, means finding answers in the heart. When we live in our heads, we miss the truth of our beingness, the truth of our heart. We're running around doing. We are not human doings. We are human beings, and we forget to be in the moment. Our brains are taking us over there. Our mind is saying, if we don't do this, then we'll never get there. I have some really bad news for you. The news is there's no there there. There is no there there. When you think you're there, you're here. You're right here where you are. Where you go, there you are. So there is no there there. We need to appreciate what is going on in the moment. And so the journey really starts when we get to the point of starting to wake up to that fact and that we are a new slate and our lives really are a story that we're co-creating with something else. That something else that we may not be able to see, but we know we have a sense of it deep within our hearts, in the core of our being. And that thing, according to Native Americans, is the seventh direction, which is where spirit resides, where the creator is. It's that beating heart that beats without our need to do anything. It beats a bazillion times a day, whether we think about it or don't think about it. No matter what we're doing, it just keeps on going. It is that thing that keeps us centered. That's where our center is, in our hearts, not in our heads. Our eyes will lie to us, our ears will lie to us, and all that we hear will lie to us. But our heart never lies. Our body never lies to us. Our life doesn't lie to us. Our life is an outpicturing of all the choices that we make each and every day. Every choice that we make, every word that we speak, every action that we take. And actions are based on perceptions, the filters of our lives, the things that we believe to be true, which are simply perceptual. They're based on the filters and all the things that were placed upon us at our birth. But the reality, the truth of us, is that we are constantly co-creating. We are constantly co-creating. Words. Words are so important. I remember as a child when someone would tease you, you'd say, oh, you know, sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt me. Words can destroy your spirit. Words can change who you are forever. When a child always hears that they don't have value, or they're shown that they don't have value in some way, or they perceive to not have value, it changes who they are forever. And then they have to find a way to get to a place where they realize they do have value. But it's words that start that process. Have any of you ever engaged in gossip? I have. You know, I think we all have. And why do we do that? Because we're in a situation with someone and we want to belong and we want to participate in what's going on. So if there's someone who is very critical and judgmental and they're talking about someone, we either listen to it and co-sign it by normalizing it, by listening to it, instead of saying, you know, I really would prefer to like not go there. That takes courage, because then they may not like you. They may think you're kind of holier than thou, so to speak. But the truth is, every time we co-sign something that diminishes another person, we are participating in an act of violence. We are participating in something that in some way is creating a false idea of who that person is, because we don't know them. we may not even know this person, you know, and our experience of that person is what we should be going on. And we should look at what is that experience being filtered through? What are we projecting on other people? Because we are projecting our own thoughts and feelings. If I hear a certain tone of voice, sometimes that tone of voice sounds to me like they may be putting me down in some way. But the truth is, it may just be a tone of voice to them. It may be how they sound. But the filter of what I have experienced before is coloring that tone of voice. So what I need to do when listening to my life, when something triggers me, is just immediately stop instead of reacting, to go within and say, wow, why is that triggering me? Where is that coming from? Who installed that trigger? When did I first feel that? You know, I need to drop that rock, you know, because I'm going to be constantly reacting to people based on something that happened in the past, not in the moment. And I need to be in this moment. I need the newness of this moment. You know, so that's what I choose to do. Our words and our actions. You know, we don't think that we affect the whole entire world. We don't think that we can change the world by just simply not participating in something, not diminishing others. Where do you spend your money? You know, often we do things out of fear that there's not enough or that we'll lose something that we have or not get something that we want. Fear of not having enough. And many of us are caught up in the financial situation of the world, which is important. Obviously, we need to be able to exist. But do we have faith that there is something greater that will lead us to the things that we need and deserve? And do we deserve those things? And if we deserve those things, we will be led, we'll be looking at our life, we'll see the opportunities around us. And when we're not thinking about what we can't get or what if I don't have that, we open a space for our good to come in. And we need to do that if we're really going to live our lives fully. I was talking to Melissa yesterday, and she gave me a perfect example of how we don't live in the moment. She was coming back from somewhere with her husband and they were driving across country and something had bothered her or triggered her and it was on her mind. And so she was talking about it and her husband was driving along, looking at the beautiful mountains and the sky and the clouds and, you know, the trees and all of the beauty around him as he was driving. And she was at the side talking away, talk the whole entire way home about what was on her mind. And when she got home, he started talking to her and he was telling her about, wow, wasn't that beautiful? Did you see the blah, 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 blah? Oh my God, I was so fascinated by this or that. So what happened during that ride was that Melissa was here and he had tuned her out and was enjoying the moment of everything around him, the beauty of everything around him. And being self-aware as she is, it struck her at that moment, wow, I missed the whole thing. I missed the beauty of each moment as we drove across country. And how often do we do that? How often are we in a situation with people and while they're talking, we're watching their lips move, but we've got a conversation going on in our head. One time I went to the first showing of animated computer animation at the Arts Museum in La Jolla many, many years ago. And at that time, the computer like filled the size of a room and the programming was intense, but I was fascinated by it. And there was a short called Double Talk. And the Double Talk was some young man was in high school and he was gonna take a girl to the prom and he thought she was gorgeous and beautiful. And he was gonna go to her house to meet her parents. And her father was a successful person who was a businessman and played golf and drank scotch. And her mom was the perfect mom with the house dress on and the hair coiffed up and perfect makeup on. And so when he went to meet her, he walked up to the door and in his mind, he was thinking, God, I wonder what they're going to be like. I don't know what it's going to be like. What if she doesn't look like her? What if she looks like her? I wonder what they're like. And then the mother opened the door and there she was, perfectly coiffed and, you know, and very, very perfect, perfect. And he said to her, oh my goodness, are you so-and-so's sister? you know, trying to flatter her. And she says, oh, no, I'm her mother. He says, oh, my God, you look wonderful. But in his mind, there was a conversation going on. Oh, they look nothing alike. I wonder if she's going to look like that when she gets older. So that was the conversation in the head, but his words were coming out something else. And then with the father looked at him before he got there, wondering what he was going to be like. And then when he showed up, and he says, oh, I'm so pleased to meet you. You're such a nice young man. And he was thinking, who is this jerk? I don't want my daughter marrying him. You know, so there was all this double talk going on. And how much do we have that double talk in our lives? You know, and do we listen to people when we are in conversation with them? What is a conversation? A conversation is a communion with someone. And that communing with someone includes they talk, and then you listen, and you don't interrupt. You listen, actively listen to what they're saying. And you look and listen to in between the words. You listen, you feel the feeling that's coming across at them. And then they shut up. And you respond. You don't negate everything they just said by talking about yourself or by interjecting your experience of what they're trying to share with you. You know, they are obviously trying to communicate something to you. So respond to that. Ask questions. That's communication. That's conversation. How often do we just listen to what someone says and then wait for them to shut up so we can talk at them about what we want to say? That happens a lot. We all do it. I'm guilty of it, and I'm aware of that I'm guilty of it. So what I do is consciously, actively force myself to not try to interject something into the conversation, unless it's something that's appropriate for the situation that might be of support to them in some way. And that's hard. That is really hard because we're human. We're human, and we all want to share our experiences. We all want to be heard. We all want to be accepted. We all want to be loved. And so there's the word thing. Now, we think that we don't have the power to change the world. This world looks chaotic right now. Our politics are chaotic. The weather is chaotic. There's a cacophony of noise coming at us night and day. What is the first thing we do when we get up in the morning? Do we turn on the news or do we open our eyes and just say thank you? I'm very blessed in that someone gave me a crystal and I put it up in the window behind me and the sun comes in from that direction. So the moment I open my eyes, what I see are little rainbows dancing all over my walls and on my ceiling. And I'm like, whoa, look at the rainbows. So I start talking to my dogs. Look at the rainbows, you know, and then I'm grateful. I just feel such gratitude and joy. And when was the last time that you had spontaneous tears? Spontaneous tears, but you just stuff them down instead of sitting with them, because that's your life talking to you. It's saying there's something unresolved. I've been watching some films about people who overcome things and who are tenacious and who don't give up. And when they finally succeed, I have this burst of feeling and just tears coming out of my life. And then out of my eyes. And then I think to myself, why am I crying? You know, why am I not just laughing? And sometimes they are tears of joy to seeing their success, but sometimes they're tears of regret, wondering, what if I had done this instead of that? And then I need to be with that. And I need to then look for the gift in the choice that I made. Like I said, some people pass through. Some people not only pass through, but they stay in your life much longer than you want them to stay in your life. It's like they weren't invited in, but they're the unexpected guest that never leaves. Like you never know how long they're going to be there. And so what you have to do is discern who fits in your life where, and why are you allowing things into your life that are toxic? Why do you cling? My grandmother used to always also have a saying. I refer to my grandmother a lot. Don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. You know, so there is a place for everyone in our lives, obviously, or they wouldn't have come into our lives. We are part of, there's this magnetism that goes on. We're part, like I said, we're part of an ocean of energy. And energy attracts energy, and energy repels energy in a certain way. So if we're attracting something, it's something that we need in our lives. You don't say, oh, why is this happening to me? That's the consciousness of victimhood. It's being done to you. You are being tossed to and fro on the ocean of life. Well, you know what? Put your big girl panties on and get on with it. That's what I say. Put your big girl panties on and realize, okay, so this happened. Now what do I do? How do I choose to react to this? What's the solution? Is there a solution? Do I need to just let this go and move on? Do I need to go look at some flowers? Do I need to stand with my feet on wet grass? Do I need to recharge myself? You know, I think of these Sunday services and when I get to participate as like owning a Tesla, a spiritual Tesla. It only has so many miles it can go on its charge. And then you have to stop, and you have to stop at either a quick charge or you need to charge for much longer in order to be able to move on. So I think of Sunday as a really in-depth, long charge to get us through to at least the middle of the week, and then maybe we might need a quick charge. You know, so we're like that electric car that needs to be recharged, and I do get recharged. I get recharged from each and every person, from the smile on their face, from the energy that they are putting forth in simply sharing their time, talent, and treasure. You know, and how are you seeing what your life is telling you? I mean, when you see someone sitting at the 7-Eleven, dejected, homeless, do you think, oh my God, I don't want to look at that? Or do you think, oh my God, there but for the grace of God could lie? How can I uplift this person in some small way? Maybe just smile and say, good morning, how are you today? Period. I have seen someone's eyes light up simply by saying, good morning, how are you today? And they look up and there's a spark in their eyes, like, I'm not invisible. You know, so I implore you to know that we are all co-creating. Where we spend our money is a co-creation, by the way. Do you, for example, who likes chocolate here? Raise your hand if you like chocolate. I love chocolate. But where do you buy your chocolate and what do you spend on your chocolate? Do you think, okay, I want 6 Hershey bars because if I buy 6, then I'll have them for a while in my refrigerator. They're cheap, they're expensive, I can afford that. Or do you spend on 1 fair trade organic bar of chocolate and eat it piece by piece? Because that choice makes a difference in lives of people clear across the globe. How they're being traded and getting that service to you. Your money either supports their hardship or it supports lifting them up so they get fair pay for what they're doing, where they get an environment that is safe to work in. I've heard of so many of places in China where there's no windows and, you know, tiny little places where they're producing things and then there's a fire and no one can get out and everyone is killed. But we get cheap clothes. We get what we want. We get high fashion for a much lower price than we would have to pay for it if we actually paid what people are worth. And you know what? Is that thing that we bought going to make a difference in our life in the long run? Is it? Is it really? Or is it what we contribute to the world? I got that message so loud and clear when I was at the Celebration of Life yesterday from Steve Cooper's life. He had a life well lived. Everything he did and touched made a difference in the lives of the people around him, the children, the people at church, the students. He created organic gardening, introduced people to things that they had never had. Do you know that here in San Diego, we are one of the most beautiful cities in the world? We have most beautiful beaches in the world. And in our, even in our inner cities, there are children who have never been to the beach. What if somebody got together, went to a school and said, let's get a bus together and take these kids to the beach. Let them experience the beach. Maybe we're not that kind of person, but maybe we can suggest it. Maybe we can take one child who's never been to the beach, to the beach, so they can share that experience with their friends. So when I say that pay attention to your life, it is always talking to you. Everything you see in your life is an outpicturing of a choice that you made. Our lives are the outpicturing of our choices and our actions and our words. Shakespeare said that life is a stage and we are all actors. So if we are all actors, is your life a drama, a comedy, a dark comedy, an adventure, an overcoming of hardship? Is it triumph? What is your life? Because remember, I'm going to leave you with this. Remember, you are the writer, the editor, the producer, the director, and the star of your own play. So you get to write that play every day. And you get to edit it at any time, any day. And so right now, right here, I leave you with that. Thank you for letting me share today. Thank you. And thank you today for each and every one of you. I want to leave you with a couple of things. One of them being, Melissa, thank you so much for doing the reading. And as many of you know, I'm kind of a stream of consciousness writer and speaker. And so what comes out in 5 minutes. And then in co-creating with Melissa, she gave the words that came out, the meaning that create the essence of what Spirit was trying to say through me, Asmi, and in me. And so you did it beautifully, Melissa, you know, and the feeling that you put into it, the way that you read it, solidified the words that went through into my heart. So those words will be with me because I could hear them from you. You know, sometimes I don't know what's coming out of my mouth. It just comes out and I hear it for the first time when you hear it. However, I just want to thank you. That was very beautiful. And the prayer, Groovy G, was wonderful. And the prayer before service, Maureen, thank you for helping me to get centered and listen to my life because we had some technical difficulties. And I found myself that was perfect. It was perfect that we were having those difficulties because Spirit didn't want us to be focused on whether the song played or not. It wanted us to be focused on the message. So I had to let go of that and say, well, don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. Let's just let it flow. Let's just go with the flow. You know, so I did listen to my life because at first I felt myself getting a little bit like, and then I thought, you know what? Let it go. Let it go. My life is saying, just move on. You know, move on. And so we did. And that's what I love about this community. And that's why I love having the opportunity to join you at least once a month. And with that being said, thank you. Thank you for each and every one of you that appeared today. And know that anyone who hears this, whether on YouTube or this morning, will hear what they need to hear, will know what they need to know at the point of reference they are in their own awareness of where they are in their evolutionary process. And so with that, I just want to say thank you. And I was so glad to be here today. So each and every one of you, bye.